This is Fox 31 Now.
Good morning. Thank you so much for tuning into Fox 31 Now. I'm Alex Rose, and we are in for a wild 48 hours coming up here in Colorado and in the Denver metro area. Welcome to another edition of Ask a Met. We did one with Jessica LaBelle yesterday. Today, we are going to be talking to Pinpoint Weather meteorologist Chris Tomer. We're going to be talking to him today and tomorrow, which is a Pinpoint Weather Alert Day, about all of this snow that we are expecting here in the Centennial State. Before we sink our teeth into this, thank you so much. I see you folks piling in on Facebook Live, so feel free to start asking your questions on Facebook Live. If you're tuning in on our website or our app, feel free to join the conversation on Twitter using the hashtag AskAMet, or shoot an email to askamet@kdvr.com. Several ways to participate, folks, and I'll flash those in a lower third as we get going here. But again, fire danger today, snow tomorrow. That is what we are focusing on with Pinpoint Weather meteorologist Chris Tomer, who joins us live here on Fox 31 Now. Chris, what is the one big takeaway that people should look at for this storm tomorrow? And again, I'm looking at your graphics. That's a lot of snow that we're forecasting up in the mountains.
Yeah, not so worried about down here. But if you live above 6,000 feet of elevation, so that's, you know, foothills, parts of the Palmer Divide, you're in for heavy, wet snow very late in the season when a lot of trees are already starting to leaf out in many cases, Alex. I think that's really where the mark of this storm is going to be left.
Absolutely. And we're already seeing a lot of your comments trickle in here on Fox 31 Now on Facebook. And so, again, keep those coming. A lot of those are going to be, you know, location-oriented, so I'm going to let them trickle in for a bit, Tomer, so I can group a couple of these together because a lot of people are wondering about specific areas. So let's just start with the timing, because Joel is wondering, when will the snow and cold weather hit in the mountains? And I imagine that this system is going to start coming in first. So let's just walk people through timing before we get into totals.
Yeah, so here's our future radar and satellite. Again, today is just hot and dry with a lot of fire danger. So we'll just press on into Friday. So you wake up Friday morning, it's already snowing up in the northern mountains, kind of dropping down towards I-70, maybe some rain showers up in Fort Collins. And then by the time we get to lunch tomorrow, we've got rain showers spreading down. So this is moving from north to south. So we're just kind of waiting on it most of the morning in Denver. Rain showers from Fort Collins to the Denver area at the lunch hour, snowing off to the west. And then by the time we get to the evening rush, we've got a rain-snow mix over most of the I-25 corridor, mainly rain up in Weld County and Greeley. The snow is continuing up in the high country. Snow starting to overtake the Palmer Divide. 6,000 feet is a key line on this. And then goes over to snow. Once the sun sets Friday night into Saturday morning, I really think that's probably the window in Denver. If we're going to pick up 2, 3, 4 inches of snow, it's probably going to happen during that timeline. And then once the sun comes up, I mean, really game off at that point, in my opinion. I mean, again, not worried about so much down here, but it's areas west and south above 6,000. And once we get past noon, I think, on Saturday, a lot of this the storm starts to move away and things will start to dry out.
Absolutely. A lot of people chiming in, and you know, people like Lori and Christy covering up their plants. Probably a good call to do that tonight, as you're going to wake up to snow starting on Friday. And I'm just,
yeah, and I've got two freezes in my forecast now, so not just one. So it's Saturday morning and Sunday morning where you're going to have to, if you just cover them, just leave them for both mornings.
Yeah, just leave it covered for the weekend. That's pretty good advice right there. I want to get into one of the technical questions, Tomer, that came in through the email. Again, you can see that on the bottom of your screen, askamet@kdvr.com. Jake Schmidt was wondering, he'd like to know, how many inches of wet spring snow are measured into liquid precipitation? And Tomer's already got a graphic for that. There you go.
Yeah. So this is the beauty, right? All storms start out, we have to know what the total liquid potential is. In Denver, we'll probably get an inch and a half of total liquid. Maybe a couple, 3, 4 inches of that is snow, but when you boil it all down at the end of the day, what's going to be in your pot or your glass is about an inch and a half of liquid, which is absolutely awesome. It's going to really save us the whole month of June. Now, to the west and to the south, above 6,000, where this is all going to be snow, what that's going to do is be it's going to generate that 1 to 2 feet of snow that we're expecting, in some cases over 2 feet of snow. This is the purest form of what you're looking at. So that gentleman's question, when you boil it down, this is the liquid value of all that.
Oh, wonderful. All right, let's start digging into what a lot of people are asking about, which is snow totals. I'm going to lump together a couple of communities in northern Colorado, Tomer. People specifically asking about Greeley, Fort Morgan, northern Fort Collins, and Erie. Yeah. And I know that that Greeley area is right around, at least when the storm comes in, near that rain-snow line. And so, you know, it's probably tougher to forecast exactly how many total inches you're going to get in that kind of community when some of it comes in at rain as rain and some comes in as snow.
Yeah. I'm assuming an 80% melt rate for most of the Front Range, Denver, Fort Collins, Greeley. So while you may see impressive snow totals out there, a lot of that's going to melt. And I think, you know, 1 to 4 inches is pretty fair for Fort Collins, Loveland, Greeley, Denver, Aurora, Centennial, up towards DIA. And a lot of that's going to happen Friday night into Saturday morning when the sun goes down and the temperatures are colder. Now, when you go off to the west into the south suburbs, you're going to get more and a lot more, you know, over towards Boulder, Lakewood, Golden, down towards Highlands Ranch, Castle Rock, Parker. You're at higher elevations there, and you will get more accumulation. I think if you have travel plans Saturday morning, we'll probably have slushy roads over most of the Front Range and out towards DIA, probably slushy roads. But the worst of it will be to the west and to the south. And especially, like I said at the top of this, the biggest concerns probably up in the foothills with all those communities running north to south from Red Feather to Estes to Allen's Park to Idaho Springs, Coal Creek, Genesee, Conifer. A lot of those places, you know, what will be the effect of this? It's so late in the year, the trees are already starting to leaf out. You know, you can't help but think that power outages might be an issue in some of these places.
Absolutely. And again, if people keep on bringing those suggestions in. Linda, if you want us to highlight a specific part of southern Colorado, just feel free to say the community and we'll try to zoom down there as well. There's the full look. You mentioned the 80% melt rate, Tomer, and I'm just curious about the concept there because I know we're going to get near 90 to get today in Denver, near a record high. The concrete, the asphalt, all that stuff is going to be warm, right? And so just talk about the factors that are going to make this snow a quick melt over the weekend and moving into next week.
I'll preface it by saying if this storm happened in March or even April, we would get buried in snow. The dynamics are just different, right? So thermodynamics are different. The marginal temperatures with this storm, we're going to be mainly in the 30s here in Denver. That's just too warm, really, this time of the year. If we were going to be in the 20s, it'd be a different ballgame. Like you said, 90 degrees the day prior, which is today. That means everything's going to be warm. You're just fighting that, those warm surfaces. The higher sun angle, absolutely critical this time of the year. I mean, it's much higher and it's much more direct in the sky. That's why it may snow like crazy during the day, and it's just like, wow, this is not accumulating, it's just melting. The sun angle, it has an effect. Once the sun goes down, that's really the best odds for getting snow accumulation here at lower elevations. Now, you can play off these and really erode these when you go up in higher elevation, because upslope's more efficient, air temps are going to be colder, typically they decrease with altitude. You're not dealing with these 90 degree temperatures up there, so it's a whole different ballgame for the foothills in particular.
Absolutely. I feel like I can answer this question. I'm going to take a stab at it. Gabrielle's wondering if we need snow tires. I don't necessarily think so. I mean, I guess it depends on where you're driving. If you're up in the high country, all that snow coming in at once certainly can be tough. But down here in the metro, I don't think that you're going to necessarily deal with that. And somebody asked about Estes Park, and I can see right there the 30 inches.
28 to 30 somewhere.
That's wild for this time of year, right?
You know, maybe this is the worst case scenario that we're forecasting here. Maybe it ends up being 20 inches. Either way, 20, 24, 30, that's a lot of snow this time of the year. No matter how you slice it, it's going to be a very high moisture content snow that weighs everything down. This won't be, you know, dry powder by any stretch of the imagination.
And Tomer, so, I do think it's one of those things to keep in mind when I see 30 inches in Estes Park and somebody comes out with a ruler, you know, a Sunday morning and they don't see 30 inches there. We're talking about the total accumulation, and a lot of this is going to melt as it goes too. So it's not like you would expect to wake up Sunday morning and see, you know, 2.5 feet of snow outside. It's going to melt as it goes.
This is tough forecasting. I mean, there's no way to put it any other way. This time of May, I mean, this is the biggest storm we've had in late May in a long, long time. I mean, to forecast 2 feet of snow in the foothills in the end of May, you know, there's a certain degree of art to all of this right now. You know, there's going to be compacting of the snow. There's going to be melting of the snow. You know, snow that falls during the day is not as efficient as snow falls during the night. So, you know, there's a wide range of totals here, Alex.
So this is like a playoff snowstorm forecast for you. It's a little more difficult. The stakes are a little higher. We're dealing with a unique situation. I'm seeing a bunch of people saying, you know, it sounds like there's graduations happening all up and down the Front Range this weekend. Some proms I heard of from our last edition of Ask a Met. And so I wouldn't be surprised, depending on where you live, if some are canceled. Hopefully it's not putting too much of a damper on that. Just because a lot of grad parties, Elbert County and Boulder, I don't know how that's going to shake out. Melissa's wondering, what might a drive Sunday morning from DIA to Colorado Springs look like? And again, by Sunday, even though we are dealing with cold temps, I would imagine that the roads would be pretty clear, at least, especially on big highways like I-25 going from Denver to Colorado Springs.
Yeah, this storm will be gone by then. Should be much, much better by Sunday morning. There's another little storm that comes in like late Sunday throughout the day on Monday. It's minor compared to this. But the bottom line is this storm will be gone by Sunday morning.
Yeah, no, that's good to know. Okay, I got a couple more communities to wrap it together. And Tina, Christy, appreciate you guys tuning in and everything and contributing. We touched on Estes Park. Let's talk about Breckenridge. There was one fellow who was interested in that, and I am just personally curious about, you know, what snow mountain resorts could see, the ones that are at least still open. This might be a sneaky late season bump for places like A Basin that try to stay open until the 4th of July.
Yeah. So let me see if I can't. There we go. Couple of things stand out here to me on this. I think in Breck, especially high on the 10-mile range, and you're probably looking at 15 to 24 inches, something like that. Down even in Buena Vista and Salida, got some friends who were asking me about a forecast down there who wanted to go rafting. I said, well, you're gonna have to do that today or Friday morning, because I mean, look at the number for Buena Vista. Even though that could be optimistic for such a low elevation community, you get the idea. I mean, it's likely we're going to see some snow accumulation all the way down to the valley floor, Chaffee County, down into Salida, the Springs, Divide, Colorado. I know there's a lot of activities going on this weekend, Saturday and Sunday mornings, especially Saturday morning. I mean, you know, we're running the risk, high risk of just snowfall accumulation in a ton of mountain communities on Saturday morning.
Absolutely. A couple of quick shout outs. I think Ann was wondering about Conifer. I snuck a peek at your previous map, and that was 19.
Yeah, I'll go back to it.
Yeah, on that side angle of the mountains. Yeah, you can see Conifer there on the left of your screen. Anna, who is wondering about that. Kim is wondering about Elizabeth, Colorado, and Grand Lake. Grand Lake looks like the other side of Long's Peak, again, in that 18 to 24 inches range. And then out in the Elbert County area in Elizabeth, you're still looking at anywhere between...
I'd say 6 to 12.
Yeah, 6 to 12. Yeah, exactly. Wonderful. And again, Christy covering her garden tonight. Good call. Probably keep it covered all the way through at least Sunday morning. And then, Tomer, let's just look ahead until next week. I mean, we're dipping down. We're going to get cold. But I think looking at the extended forecast, we're looking at pretty beautiful weather this time next weekend.
Yeah, so the issue here, once you establish such a big sort of, as we call it, trough in the atmosphere, it can be tough to crawl out of. So Sunday's you know, I wish it would, we thought it might be warmer a couple of days ago, but now it looks like we're going to be stuck in the upper 40s to about 50 on Sunday. And yeah, a couple of rain showers in the afternoon, maybe a couple of showers or storms Monday afternoon, but eventually we'll dry out Tuesday, Wednesday, and probably Thursday.
Yeah. It that makes perfect sense to me. I think about the melt factor and everything. I think about watering my lawn and just knowing that, you know, this stuff is going to dump good moisture on there, which it desperately needs. I still need to set up sprinklers. And so, yeah.
You know, this is, so we've had 28 red flag warnings so far this year. That's the most on record for so early. Yeah. So, without this storm system, June would have been a huge problem for wildfires. This is probably going to save us from a bad June. To be really honest about it. I mean, because we probably would have had red flag warnings if we wouldn't have got a storm like this, probably just all the way through June, because it's going to start to heat up. Most days will hit 90 in June, so that dries everything out. And you know, the wind has been an issue with this La Nina pattern, so the deck was stacked against us. This storm is really what we needed. Unfortunately, it's going to be so cold and the snow is going to be so heavy, but we really need the moisture.
Yeah, and I was talking to Jess, Pinpoint Weather meteorologist Jessica LaBelle yesterday, and we were just talking about we got basically nothing in the Front Range in terms of precipitation, moisture, any measurable snow in April, and April is, you know, the second snowiest month historically, so this is almost kind of a counteractive storm, and we saw that early moisture in early May, nothing really since, so that's good. Linda's wondering, do you think flights are going to be canceled on Friday as this storm comes in? Obviously, depends on when you fly, but that's the bulk of the system, so a late flight Friday, say that five times fast, probably in jeopardy of getting delayed?
You know, I mean, I'm not huge. I'm going to run the timeline out so you can kind of see. So there's noon, rain, snow mix at 5 p.m. Then it does go over to snow once the sun sets. I'm not hugely worried about DIA. Yeah. I think there's going to be a ton of melting. The wind doesn't look like it's going to be hurricane force or anything like that. You know, I think you might run the risk. They're going to have to de-ice Friday night, Saturday morning. That might be the most trickiest time frame to fly out of DIA, but you know, I think I'm not really terribly worried about Denver International, just because of the warmer aspect of the storm and the melting.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, just looking at the timing of this thing, it doesn't even, it starts as rain, but the snow doesn't really get to DIA, which would probably cause more issues for the airport until 5 o'clock Friday night. So again, if it's a late flight, then who knows? Let's see. Can we talk about timing? Chris Powers is wondering, when will the tunnel start seeing freezing conditions? That's a great question, because we know it can get slippery up by Eisenhower, especially if we're talking about a Friday night when there is a lot of traffic up to the mountains after work.
I would say this is Friday morning. So by Friday morning, the system is already moving. It's already snowing in the northern mountains by tomorrow morning. It's dropping down towards I-70 in the morning. Certainly, it'll already be snowing by late in the morning at the tunnel, and certainly by lunch. So it's happening sometime in the morning towards lunch where it moves into the tunnel. And then by the time we get to lunch, it's much heavier. So it initiates in the morning, late morning, and then it's really in place by lunch into the afternoon.
So, Gabrielle, I know that you were asking, does it come in tonight? I'm coming from Vail to Denver. If you're driving into Denver tonight, you should be just fine. You're going to be fine tonight. It's more about travel
tomorrow.
Linda says that her flight out of DIA is around 7:40 p.m. We don't have a crystal ball here, Linda. Chris Tomer is much smarter than I am, but I would just go on a wild guess and just say, just continuously throughout the day, probably check in with your flight.
The only issue today will be wind this afternoon.
Yeah. So 7:40, her flight tomorrow. Christy's wondering about Red Feather Lakes area, up in north of Fort Collins, northwest of Fort Collins, and it looks
quite
like
a bit
again
in for Red Feather.
Yeah, I was about to say that whole area. Wow. Have you ever seen this much snow this late in the season in the mountains? I know it's snowed in like June, right? We've had that happen, but not like a significant system like the one we're seeing.
No, it's so late for this. Maybe you get a foot in the mountains if everything is perfect in May or June or July or August. I mean, it can snow any month, but man, everything's got to be perfect. To crank out 2 feet, that's really pushing the odds of everything coming together. It just so happens that, you know, this season, the La Nina is the strongest it's been. It actually strengthened, strongest it's been by May standards since 2000. Oh, wow. La Nina is the only way something like this could come together, with the type of setup of the jet stream anchored in place. It really leaves the door wide open to just a storm coming in, a cold front coming in from the north like this. And I mean, to get this kind of upslope this late, it's pretty amazing.
Yeah, no, I think it's absolutely fascinating. And obviously we need the moisture. So as we're winding down here on Ask a Met on this edition on Fox 31 Now, feel free to get in your final questions. The question that I have for you, Tomer, is we're dealing with a couple of different wildfires in the state right now. I believe it's the Pumtaw fire, which is burning near Pagosa Springs. And I think that they had some good overcast, and firefighters were able to establish some lines over there. But it looks like that area is just going to miss out on any precip. So I was just curious if they're going to get any relief in terms of moisture down there on that fire.
Not much, I'll tell you. Wolf Creek might get a couple of inches out of this thing. The high sand grays, Crestones might get 6, 7, 8 inches. Maybe a scattered rain shower in Alamosa, San Luis Valley, but mainly wind. This is not a great storm for Southern Colorado.
Yeah.
Not even close, unfortunately, because that's where the snowpack, let me see if I've got this set up. I do. We've seen one of the fastest meltouts on record in the San Juans and the Rio Grande basin. So that's like Wolf Creek over to Telluride, parts of the Silverton area. If you haven't seen any pictures from that area right now, you'd be absolutely blown away. It's like winter. I mean, it's like most of the snow's gone. That's what meltout refers to. And you know, you have to go back to 2002, which was probably the biggest drought year in Colorado we've ever seen. And 2018 was really bad too. But, you know, Wolf Creek had a 385-inch winter, and most of it's gone.
That's wild.
You know, we've had some of the most significant dust events we've seen on record. All that dust that blew in April and early May destroyed the snowpack in southern Colorado. And now you're just starting to see these little fires break out. That's exactly what happened in 2018. We started to see those little fires break out, and it was a forewarning to what was coming. I can't remember if it was 2018. They shut down the entire San Juan National Forest, which had been unprecedented. I mean, never seen anything like it. So we have to be really careful what happens in southern Colorado. Unfortunately, Alex, we're just not going to get any help from this storm really in that area.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, final question for Chris Tomer before we wrap up here on Ask a Met. Tina Marie asking about Loveland around Carter Lake. And again, I think that we're talking about that area, the foothills that or just along the Front Range, I should say, that's in between 6 to 12 right now.
Yeah.
Four.
It's definitely tricky. The west side of Loveland will get more snow than Loveland proper. That's for sure.
Yeah.
So, you know, Loveland, Fort Collins, Denver Metro, 1 to 4, tons of melting. It may snow like crazy for a long time, but a lot of it will probably melt. But on the west side, you know, you start going up towards Devil's Backbone, Masonville, especially up towards Horsetooth, and you're in for a lot of snow in some of those areas. I mean, as soon as you click into 6,000 feet or higher, a lot of snow on the way.
Well, we desperately need it, and so we'll take all the moisture that we can get here on the Front Range, the foothills, and up in the high country. Again, Pinpoint Weather meteorologist Chris Tomer joining us here for this edition of Ask a Met on Fox 31 Now. Tomer, thank you so much. I'm going to wrap things up, if you don't mind.
Yeah, we'll do this again tomorrow.
Yeah.
I always appreciate everybody chiming in. We'll do it again tomorrow.
Exactly. That's what I'm teasing ahead to. So thank you so much, Tomer. Again, so if you folks are unfamiliar with this whole setup, we're launching this new series called Ask a Met. That's Ask a Meteorologist, where you can go ahead and ask your questions of our great Mets here on Fox 31 Now. And so again, I'm just going to fix up this graphic real quick so that, let's see here. Beautiful. So again, 10:20 tomorrow morning with Chris Tomer, roughly around the same time. We're going to do the same thing. Tomorrow is a Pinpoint Weather Alert Day. That's the day the storm comes in. So we're going to have better data as we get closer to this storm. Again, if you weren't able to get in a question now, I encourage you to just email us at askmed@kdvr.com. And we usually stack those questions up first for these kind of streams. So that we could get them off the bat. As always, you could also join us on Facebook Live or join the conversation on Twitter using the hashtag right there on your screen. Christy, Tina Marie, Lonnie, Alicia, thank you so much for tuning in. Really appreciate the feedback. And cover up those plants, folks. I think Christy was mentioning that earlier. I know I certainly need to do the same. Got to keep them covered until Sunday. That's going to do it for me here on Fox 31 Now. I'm Alex Rose. Thank you so much for tuning in. We'll catch you again at 10:20 tomorrow morning with Chris Tomer. We'll be right back.